Okay. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Dr. Kurt Woeller. I'm a biomedical physician. I've been in practice now since 1998. I practice in Southern California in a town just north of San Diego called Murrieta. I've been here for over a number of years. I've been in Southern California for most of my life. And I've been a biomedical physician now with the Defeat Autism Group since 1998. And I have a wide variety of experience with kids of all ages on the autism spectrum, implementing a wide variety of biomedical therapies, from dietary therapy to B12 to Candida to chelation therapy to hyperbarics. So the list kind of goes on as far as things that I've done in my professional career now for over 11 years. And I've also been doing a lot of these webinars over the past couple of years with Great Plains, as well as doing my own presentations locally and nationally as well. So hopefully, if this is the first time you're listening to me, you'll find the information informative, and that you'll get a lot out of this, because I really try to give some detailed information, but also try to take some difficult concepts sometimes to understand and really bring it down to that basic level of what's most important to understand. So let's go ahead and get started here. Okay, as I mentioned before, the overview for this lecture is I'm going to recap just some basic information from last month, and then we're going to touch more specifically on something called biofilms, and just really an overview and treatment example of something called a biofilm program, and then we'll end it by talking about specific treatments for yeast. If you have not at this point read this book, I'd encourage you to do so. This was one of the first books that I read from Dr. Shaw from Great Plains Laboratory a number of years ago. And the reason I like this book is he really goes into really in-depth with respects to issues revolving around yeast, chronic yeast infections, candida issues, bacterial problems, and the metabolic toxins that these things secrete and how they affect people's health, as well as children on the autism spectrum. So of all the books out there, this is a great one, a good one to start with. And there's a lot of good books, but I like this book, and a lot of the information I took from this presentation, or is on this presentation, is actually taken from this book, and information that I've learned over the years in my clinical practice, but also information that I've learned from Dr. Shaw. Now, when we're talking about yeast, we know it generally is a vicious cycle, and you know, we start with some type of infectious process, you know, whether it's a parasitic infection, a bacterial infection, child is given antibiotics, which tends to wipe out the friendly bacteria in the gut, and the yeast that are sitting there take advantage of that situation and start to overgrow. Now, we know that these yeast can also secrete toxins, and over time, this can tend to weaken the immune system, where essentially we just get this vicious cycle that moves around and around and around, and this is something we see quite commonly with kids on the spectrum. Now, this is an image of Candida on the tongue of an individual here, and so oral pharyngeal candidiasis is a serious problem. And this picture, you know, admittingly is not necessarily from a child with autism, probably somebody who has severe, you know, compromised immune system. But you probably look in your kid's mouth, and you may see at times that their tongue tends to be coated with this white plaque. Now, as you go further down the digestive system, you can see Candida overgrowth quite severely, and this is through an endoscopy where they're looking down the esophagus with an endoscope camera and taking images of what the mucosal tissue looks like. And you see here on the left-hand side normal-looking tissue, and then on the right-hand side we just see a widespread overgrowth of yeast. I also want to just give you kind of a heads up here. I have some drawing tools, so I've got something that can give me a little bit of a highlighter, or I may have a red dot that you might see move around on the screen. So if you see me doing that, there's a reason. I'm just trying to kind of give you an idea of trying to highlight something for you here. Mostly, however, I'll be using this pointed cursor. All right, now Candida comes in different forms, which we'll talk about. This is just an image of Candida albicans, which is the most common form of yeast. And we can see here that it starts budding, and as it starts budding with these arm-like structures, this is an indication that the Candida is moving into more of an invasive form. I'm going to go a little bit quickly through these slides, more so than I did last month, because this is a little bit of a recap, and then I'll slow things down as we get more into the realm of the biofilms. So we know that Candida is a very complex organism, and it essentially exists in four different stages. One is called the single-celled, which is essentially where it has its own life cycle. It has its, all its own internal metabolic, you know, organelles, things that allow for it to exist on its own. And then some of these yeast can be start to develop into colonies. You can also find Candida in what's called a cyst-like and a cell wall deficient form, and we'll talk more about that. And there's a wide variety of different types of Candida. You have to think of these things as sort of family members within the same family. So Tropicalis and Glabrata and Parasipalis and others are all within that family of Candida. Now, if you've ever done an organic acid test from Great Plains, the first box on the first page, you're looking at yeast and fungal markers. And the ones that we most commonly look at is arabinose. This is a very common presentation to show up, citromolic, 3-oxygluteric, and tartaric, arabinose. I see this over and over and over, but arabinose is most common. And so if you haven't done this test, I'd encourage you to do so, because there's a tremendous amount of information you can actually get from this test. One of the things that I have on a website I created at autismactionplan.com is the ability for people to actually order an organic acid test or a comprehensive digestive stool analysis to be able to do some further testing on their child. Because I know some of you out there may not be working with a doctor and don't have access to some of this testing, and that's what I've made available on this website, is for individuals such as yourself to actually have access to these tests, and actually you can order right through the website, and the test will be processed for you. And also on the Action Plan website, I have a test interpretation center. Essentially, this is an area where you can take your child's organic acid test or the comprehensive digestive stool analysis, go in, and there's downloadable PDF files that help sort of walk through each section as far as what the different markers indicate. And I have recorded video on here as well as in-depth analysis of what these different markers mean, and, you know, additional information about how to proceed with treatment. So this website has a lot of different types of information, support material for you. I'll talk to you a little bit here at the end as far as some other things that I have available, which I think you'll find interesting. All right. On the organic acid test, primarily what we're looking at is we're looking at byproducts of yeast. We know that arabinose is one of the main byproducts of Candida. And in anybody's body, in my body, your body, we're going to have a certain level of bacteria, and we're going to have a certain level of yeast in our digestive system. And we're going to have, at any one time, a certain amount of yeast byproduct that might be spilling into our bloodstream, and then it spills over into the urine that you can collect in very small amounts on testing. Now, that can be a normal process of what's happening in most people's bodies, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you're sick or that you're neurologically impaired by these yeast organisms. However, let me move through this here. When we've taken an antibiotic, or we have a chronic immune problem, or our diet is very high in sugar or other toxic foods, when the normal flora of the digestive tract are either eliminated or reduced significantly, the yeast that are sitting there can become problematic. And that's exactly what this is showing. We went through from a normal situation to a situation where we've taken antibiotics, and you can see the yeast byproducts have just increased exponentially here, and we're able to measure this through the urine. And that's typically what we're seeing with a lot of kids in their organic acid tests. Now, the arabinose is something that's not unique to autism. So just because we're finding it in autistic kids doesn't mean that other individuals don't have arabinose as well, because you'll find people with cancer and diabetes and heart disease and chronic fatigue will also have arabinose levels high because their bodies carry yeast too. And we know that there are neurotypical kids and individuals who can have these yeast markers as well. However, when they've looked at studies that have looked at large groups of individuals, large groups of kids on the spectrum, they know that on average, kids on the autism spectrum tend to have higher levels of arabinose than, say, neurotypical kids of the same age. So it's not necessarily unique to autism, but what tends to be unique to them, at least with these kids, is that their levels of arabinose are much higher. And that's something I certainly have seen clinically in my practice as well. And we know that these yeast numbers, as I mentioned before, can change quite dramatically just with diet. So we've taken one situation here with a mouse where they gave plain water and found maybe just a little bit of yeast. But when they've added sugar water to this mouse, the yeast levels go up significantly. And we've seen that all the time. You hear all the time about an anti-candida diet or specific carbohydrate diet, these types of diets that are trying to reduce the level of available sugar so that the yeast that are present either diminish or go away. Now, we also know a lot about antifungal therapy. We use antifungal therapy quite a bit. I use it in my practice, and many other biomedical physicians use it as well. We'll talk more specifically about what are some different types of antifungal therapy. But this is just an example here of 10 days of nystatin in the types of reductions that you can see in just looking at arabinose levels. So we know that when we give nystatin, which is a specific antifungal, has a direct inhibiting effect on candida, that we see a dramatic decrease in arabinose levels. It's not necessarily normal or gone 100% all the time, but we know that it is an effective treatment, and therefore we can get an indication that that arabinose level is specifically coming from yeast. Well, one of the other things that is important to recognize as far as yeast and the toxic byproducts of yeast is that those toxic byproducts can have a direct impact upon our metabolism. And with kids on the spectrum, we know that in the cellularly, with respect to, you know, cellular metabolism as far as how their body produces energy chemicals that help to run their digestive system, run their cardiovascular system, run their brain and nervous system, that we need a constant supply of nutrients that flow through this cycle to keep things working effectively. And we do know that some of the yeast byproducts can interfere with a few of these steps. Now, the Krebs cycle is a metabolic system, a biochemical system that takes place in what's called the mitochondria of the cell. The mitochondria are these little energy factories inside our cells that produce most of the energy that our body uses to make things work effectively. And we know that more and more research is pointing to the fact that kids on the autism spectrum, at least some of them, have a susceptibility to having some type of mitochondrial problem. Not necessarily a mitochondrial disease, but some type of disorder or imbalance in the way their mitochondria function. And one of the contributing things to that can be yeast. Well, one of the byproducts of yeast, specifically candida, is a chemical called tartaric acid. Now, tartaric acid has been around a long time. It's used as a food preservative. You find it in wines. It can be found in lemon and lime flavored drinks, grape drinks. But in large amounts, it can be toxic. And one of the things that yeast produce as a byproduct of their own metabolism is tartaric acid. The problem with that is tartaric acid in high amounts can inhibit certain metabolic pathways within the Krebs cycle, within the mitochondria of the body, and specifically tartaric acid inhibits an enzyme called fumarase. And what fumarase does is it helps to produce a chemical called malic acid. And I'll talk about that here more specifically with respect to another chemical that does the same thing. Malic acid is important because malic acid is needed as a backup source for blood sugar conversion. Essentially, when our blood sugar runs low, our body has the ability to, you know, through our metabolic system, through our mitochondrial activity, to increase blood glucose levels by activating malic acid, and blood sugar is one of the main fuel sources for brain function. So if we have anything that affects the way our body can process and use malic acid and therefore have an effect on blood sugar, will have a direct effect on brain function. And we know that a lot of people with chronic fatigue, fibromyalgia, etc., will tend to many times have problems in their malic acid and tend to have problems with hypoglycemia. And this is something I've seen with kids as well, who sometimes can become quite erratic as far as behaviorally goes, attention and focusing when their blood sugar runs low. So a potential source for that problem is yeast. Well, another byproduct of yeast metabolism is another chemical called citromolic acid. And citromolic acid is essentially very similar to tartaric acid in that it too can also inhibit malic acid formation. So essentially, if we look at all three, we have malic acid here, which is the primary source for helping to maintain normal levels of blood sugar, particularly in times of stress. And then we have tartaric acid and citromolic acid, which will tend to block that conversion. And this is what this picture is showing here. So we as we're moving from, you know, clockwise here around the Krebs cycle, as we move down, we go from succinic acid to malic acid. Essentially, tartaric acid blocks this position right here. So the bottom line really is, you don't have to remember all this biochemistry stuff, is just understand that a chronic yeast problem can have a direct effect on metabolism, and metabolism is what produces energy chemicals in the body, and energy chemicals in the body are needed by every cell of the body to function appropriately. And that can be from muscles to heart to lungs to bone cells to liver cells to digestive cells to the brain. Now, we talked about the using nystatin before in respects to dropping levels of arabinose. Same thing here. We can get a decrease in any one of these metabolic toxins with an antifungal. Tartaric acid is being illustrated here by specifically going after yeast. So we know that in this case, where we see these drops, that the tartaric acid is specifically being produced because of the yeast overgrowth. Excuse me one second here. Okay. One of the other things that we look for with respects to yeast is stool cultures. And you've probably, if you haven't done this, you probably will. And this is one of the other tests that is available from the Autism Action Plan website. And this is looking at yeast on culture. And essentially what we're doing here is we're collecting stool, and you're putting it in what's called a Petri dish. And this Petri dish is then taken to the lab, and they'll, you know, analyze it and determine what type of yeast is growing in the Petri dish and then try to identify it. And this is what Great Plains is doing with respects to their comprehensive digestive stool analysis. Once they've been able to identify it, you then want to do what's called a sensitivity profile. And this is just another example of a Candida culture. Here we have three different forms of Candida. If you look and have ever done a comprehensive digestive stool analysis, I think it's page 4, of that test is where you get what's called the sensitivity profile. And this is where they've taken these samples and they're testing the yeast against these different items, whether it is a medication like Diflucan or Nystatin or Ketoconazole, which is called Nizoral, or a bunch of different natural agents, different herbal remedies to see what's effective. Essentially, the R means the organism, in this case the Candida, is resistant to Diflucan or Fluconazole. So it wouldn't be a good choice to use it. However, you could use something like Nystatin or Ketoconazole or Berberine, Caprylic Acid, Golden Seal, or Oregano in this particular situation, and those would have more of an effect at eradicating the yeast. So you, basically the bottom line here is you stay away from any of the R's. Okay, and this is essentially what they're doing. Here is our Petri dish. We're dropping in little pellets into the Petri dish, and you're looking for an expanding zone of influence. And as the further this zone moves, the more effective that medication or herbal remedy has been against the yeast. Okay, and they determine the width of that zone depending on the, and that gives measuring that gives an indication of whether something is resistant or sensitive. So remember, if it's sensitive, if it has an S next to it, that's what you're looking to use. If it has an R next to it, it means the bug is resistant to that medication. Okay, we talked a little bit about arabidose. Let's expand on the concept here of arabidose and give you a little bit more information on that. Okay, check one thing here real quick. Arabidose is a type of sugar. Now there is a compound called D-arabitol, also called D-arabinitol, which can normally be found in humans, and it has been associated with an overload of candida. However, arabidose is not something that metabolically is normally found in humans. And so the feeling here is that somehow in the human body, possibly due to bacterial conversion, arabitol is being converted into arabidose. The bottom line here is when you do the organic acid test and you see that arabidose high, most likely it's being caused by yeast. Now, there can be a couple other sources of arabidose, and these can usually, you know, come about in very small amounts. Apples, for example, will contain, whether you're using apple juice or apple sauce, contain arabidose. And so there are specific instructions when you do the organic acid test to eliminate certain foods like apples prior to collecting the urine sample so we don't get any types of false positives. So, as I mentioned before, we know that arabidose has a direct effect on metabolic systems, particularly within the mitochondria. But arabidose also has another unique capacity to do some damage, unfortunately. Arabidose will many times interact with various proteins. And what's happening here is that the arabidose is this particular, what's called an aldehyde group, is attaching itself to various proteins, particularly what's called this epsilon amino acid group. And in this case, we're getting arabidose coming together with lysine. And that complex, that arabidose-lysine complex, will then seek out and attach to an amino acid called arginine. The problem with this is arginine is an amino acid that's very much involved in controlling blood pressure. It has a direct effect over immune function. It helps with the processing of ammonia in the body. It helps release growth hormone, regulates insulin, and a lot more different types of functions in the body. So that arabidose-lysine complex now comes together complexes with arginine, and it forms this large molecule called pentosidine. And pentosidines essentially accumulate, and they cause all different types of problems. Essentially, when the pentosidine forms, it can start to create what are called cross-linking with different types of structural proteins in the body, things like collagen, our connective tissue, and our muscles. So it can have a direct effect over the flexibility and the integrity of the physical structure of our body. They can inhibit certain enzymes which are necessary for metabolism. It has a direct effect over things like biotin, lipoic acid, and vitamin B6. Vitamin B6 we know is very important for kids on the spectrum with respects to attention, focusing. It's involved in the methylation cycle. So one of the benefits that we may see with some kids is when they take high dose B6, they become more calm, they become more focused. It may be in those kind of situations that the functional vitamin deficiency of B6 is being caused by, or at least contributed by, an overproduction of pentosidines. It's difficult to say. We know that pentosidines can cause problems in the brain cells in clearing what are called neurofibrillary tangles. These are things that have been a diagnostic clue for Alzheimer's disease. And they can cause direct damage to myelin. Myelin is that fatty coating around our nerve cells. The nerve cells increase the speed of electrical conductivity from one cell to the next by a process of jumping these myelin gaps along the nerve terminals. So anytime you have damage in those areas, that can disrupt the way cell-to-cell communication can happen. And we know that pentosidines can also create a problem where, as they attach themselves to different proteins and different tissues of the body, can be a stimulus for autoimmune reactions. And this is just a picture here of these neurofibrillary tangles where we develop these tangle-like formations inside cells and also develop what are called amyloid plaques. Okay. That's something you specifically see in Alzheimer's. All right, so different stages of fungi. Essentially, fungi is a biological group of organisms. Yeast, whether it's Candida or another one called Saccharomyces, molds, and mushrooms all fall under that general category of fungus or fungi. And there's, as I mentioned before, there's four different stages of Candida. You have the single cell, the colony form, the cyst-like form, and then also the cell wall deficient form. The cell wall deficient forms are difficult to see. Most likely they're going to be imaged through an electron microscopy type of examination, which isn't something readily available to all of us, but it does exist. Usually it's the colony form, also called mycelium, and the cyst-like forms, which are generally causing the tissue-like invasion that's so problematic. And this is just an image here of yeast growing. You can see here it has this extension here, this sort of this this body, this structure here projecting downwards. This is an invasive form of Candida. And this is just an image here of yeast moving from a passive to invasive form. Essentially, as a single cell, it started to change its shape, it starts to bud, you start to get multiple budding yeast, and then you start to develop these pseudohypha and then these hyphal extensions, which at that point is becoming invasive. The way I like to describe yeast is, if you think about it, yeast by itself in very small amounts is a normal part of our digestive system. It's in our food, it can be in our water, it's a normal part of our environment. And when these things are living in harmony and the other bacteria in the gut and the immune system is keeping these in check, you don't have problems. When the yeast start to change shape, when they change form, is when they become problematic and invasive. And the way I've described this before, it's like having a dog in your neighborhood. It can be a very friendly dog, and you know, when it's by itself. However, if that dog gets out and stays out and packs together with other dogs and stays in that pack, that friendly dog can take on that pack mentality and become a real threat. In this case, you may have a single-celled yeast, but as it starts to bud and form colonies with other yeast, it takes on that pack mentality and at that point can become invasive. And we know that Candida and some of these yeast can become invasive throughout the body. This is just an example here of microabscesses of yeast growing in the spleen, but it can move throughout the body. We're not seeing these types of invasive yeast problems in kids on the autism spectrum. In these kinds of situations like this, these types of situations would mostly be seen in people with end-stage cancer or who are chemotherapy where their immune system is being wiped out, HIV patients, end-stage AIDS patients who are very, very immune compromised. That doesn't mean we don't see yeast problems in kids on the spectrum where they have a lot of behavioral issues tied to it, but we're not seeing kids dying of yeast, okay? All right. Another issue with yeast is something called gliotoxins. And essentially what these are immune system toxins that are produced by some of these organisms that have a direct effect on inhibiting overall immune function. And when you start to inhibit various immune cells, you leave the body predisposed to other infections, whether it's other bacterial infections, but specifically things like lymphocytes, viral infections. So we've seen some kids who definitely carry a lot of viral issues in their body, and yeast may be long-term a contributing factor to that. Another issue with yeast that's important to understand is just the overall, I've talked a lot about some of the chemicals and how they affect metabolism. We talked about gliotoxins. We talked about the different invasive forms of yeast. Well, we know that yeast also has the ability to cross-react with various foods. And one interesting thing that Dr. Vojani from Immunoscience had found is that Candida by itself can cross-react with what's called cross-react with various tissues in the body, whether it's the spleen, brain, or kidney. And I showed that spliced image of that spleen before. And what's happening is that chemicals found that yeast produce in this particular circumstance can actually cross-react with gluten. And there is a particular type of protein found in wheat called alpha-gliadin. And there's a similar protein found in yeast. So there can be a cross-reactivity that goes on where yeast, in secreting the chemicals that it produces, can cause that person's immune system to attack wheat if it's eaten. And that can, over time, develop into a gluten intolerance, or at least the yeast can make the gluten intolerance worse. So, and we've seen this where you see a lot of kids have a tremendous amount of food sensitivities. You do a food IgG test, and it's like everything they eat is through the roof. Usually you're looking at some type of a leaky gut situation, but if they also have a lot of yeast going on at the same time, it may be that you're getting yeast organisms that are interacting with the food and causing a cross-reactivity problem in the body, where normally the immune system is attacking the yeast, but now it's attacking the food as well. Yeast can also produce a chemical called acetaldehyde. And acetaldehyde can react with various proteins in the body, similar to what arabinose does. We know that arabinose hooks up with lysine, which then hooks up with arginine to cause these pentosidines. Well, acetaldehyde can have a similar reaction. One of the things is that acetaldehyde is very similar to formaldehyde. And one of the theories as far as chronic yeast problems, it's not something that's been absolutely proven here, but I'm just trying to lay down some information for you, is that one theory is that some kids have developed chronic yeast problems, or at least immune reactivity in their body because of vaccine reactions. And one potential link is immune reactivity to formaldehyde found in certain vaccines like the DPT. And when you create that type of situation now, you are increasing the chance for autoimmune reactions, which means self-regulating or self-attacking immune cells attacking our own body. And that's essentially what's happening in the autoimmune processes. And then essentially the acetaldehyde reaction tends to get a little bit more in depth as acetaldehyde tends to be converted into alcohol in the body. And this is where we start getting into situations where some kids act drunk when their yeast levels are high. Their behavior gets quite erratic. And essentially what's happening is that you've got an enzyme conversion of some of these chemicals, these byproducts of yeast, being converted into alcohol, and essentially some kids act as though they're inebriated, that they're basically drunk with alcohol. And so if you've seen that with your kids, it's a reality. I mean, it happens chemically, it's happening biochemically in the body, and you haven't been giving them wine or a beer, okay? It's because their body is creating the acetaldehyde and creating the alcohol effect from that. There's a lot of other chemicals that are used in our body that many times yeast can interfere with. Interesting one here is sometimes you will see on an organic acid test other markers that show up in other sections that don't always relate to yeast. And they can appear in some of those sections that would be specific to genetic disorders or what are called inborn errors of metabolism, you know, specifically pointing more towards a genetic disease. However, they're not high enough to really warrant any further investigation or to really indicate that that's really the cause. But they're chemicals that do show up in that group. And one example of this is 3-hydroxy-3-methylglutaric. And this is a genetic disorder where this particular chemical accumulates and, you know, can become problematic because some of these chemicals are used to make steroid hormones and other chemicals. But we know that yeast itself can basically create chemicals very similar to it, but they're just not in the level that would indicate a genetic disease. So the bottom line here is if you've done an organic acid test and you've seen a few of these other markers show up and you look at the interpretation in the back, and if you're looking at a level that maybe is, you know, is 50 to 75 to 100, you know, with some of these things, the chances are is if there are yeast markers elevated, that some of these other markers are high because of the yeast. And so many times just implementing an antifungal program, this is diet, supplements, medication, you come back and retest things a number of months later, many times you'll see these other markers have self-corrected themselves. Now, one of the things that yeast can do is they can embed themselves in different colonies. If you look at this picture here of the mucosal membrane, we have these finger-like projections which stick out, which increases the absorptive surface of the digestive tract. And these different blocks are would be different types of cells. This could be a cell that secretes enzymes, or it might be a cell that is secreting immune factors, or it'd be a cell that's absorbing nutrients. Okay, and you'll get pockets of yeast that are in different areas. It's not like you're getting one long coating. The problem is that some of these organisms, like the bacteria, the normal bacteria, and some of the pathogenic bacteria, there can be a lot of competition that goes on when you have yeast and another bacteria that are competing with each other for position in the gut. A good example of this is an organism called Clostridia, which is a bacteria. And there's a lot of different Clostridia bacteria. But in general, Clostridia bacteria and yeast will tend to compete with each other. And so sometimes when you do an organic acid test, you'll look and see that the arabinose level is high. It could be 200, 300, 400. And then you may find that the HPHPA level is also high, 300, 400, 500. If all you did at that point was start to treat the yeast, you could make the Clostridia situation worse. Now, what happens is that you have to many times look at behavioral issues with respect to yeast problems. Yeast usually, from a classic standpoint, will affect kids neurologically, and they'll become very stemmy. They may have lack of eye contact. They could be, you know, physically stemming, vocally stemming, visually stemming. Goofiness, giddiness, silliness, inappropriate laughter. It's not an interactive type of thing. They're very goofy, giddy, and silly within themselves. Okay, that would be sort of a typical picture of yeast. Clostridia bacteria in a neurologically sensitive child could be more, on the flip side of that, aggressive, self-injurious, easily tantruming, mood swings. Now, I don't want to indicate and give the impression that all of those issues are specifically related to yeast and bacteria, but in many kids, those things can contribute to and worsen. So those would be sort of the classic picture of Clostridia behavior versus yeast behavior. When you have both things going on, sometimes the picture gets a bit muddy. However, when you start treating, and you start, if you were only starting to treat yeast, you're giving an antifungal, or you're giving anti-yeast, you know, herbal remedies, and you have done nothing with the Clostridia, sometimes the Clostridia levels can get worse. So instead of your child who went from goofy, giddy, and silly, lack of eye contact, high stimming, instead of that stuff improving, now all of a sudden they switch and they're self-injurious, they're aggressive, they're severely agitated. And I have seen this on occasion with kids. And the reason was the Clostridia was not being addressed simultaneously, and essentially the competitive inhibition has been lifted and the Clostridia just tend to get worse. So I've always been a stickler. Before I will start treating yeast in a child, when they come into my office, they may have classic yeast presentation. They may have classic yeast behavior, but I'm always going to get an organic acid test first so I know where the Clostridia stands, because I don't want to make the situation worse. And if the Clostridia is present, then that needs to be addressed too, usually with things like antibiotics, sometimes probiotics that will take care of those. One probiotic, for example, is Culturelle. And Culturelle is a specific type of probiotic which will actually attack the Clostridia. The other things that some of these organisms can do, like the yeast, is it can share genetic information with bacteria. So it basically strengthens the colony overall in the gut, making it that much more difficult to eradicate. Interestingly is that the yeast, long-standing yeast, can actually share genetic information with the normal cells of the intestinal tract. And think about that for a second. If you got yeast, and we're talking specifically tonight about yeast, but if you got yeast interacting and sharing genetic information with your own intestinal cells, there's a real likelihood here that in those types of situations it would be extremely difficult to ever completely normalize the yeast levels because there is a real symbiotic relationship happening as those cellular forms are sharing information. One of the other problematic things about yeast is they can create something called biofilms. And this is the part of the lecture now that we're going to talk specifically about biofilms and kind of what they are and how to deal with it. But unfortunately, biofilms can make it very difficult to eradicate yeast problems. Biofilms, essentially, you have to think of this conceptually here, is biofilms has been a phenomenon that's been around, you know, at least recognized in medicine now for quite some time. It's been recognized a lot in, you know, in the field of engineering, particularly the area of engineering that deals with water treatment, water flow, transportation of water, and water treatment facilities, because you can get accumulation of bacterial biofilms. But biofilms essentially is this, think of it like a gel or this mucilaginous material that gets secreted by these organisms, and these organisms live within this biofilm as a protective barrier. Let me show you some pictures of this. This is an example of yeast biofilms from a particular type of fungus growing in wine. So we know that in the wine industry, they can get biofilm formation as a normal process of yeast fermentation. And essentially, the F-L-O-R, the floor, is where the yeast are. We get this layering effect, and we see these colonies here of yeast, and we get these colonies of yeast lying up against this biofilm, and this biofilm is a transport medium for nutrients, as well as a way to deliver oxygen and get rid of some of the metabolic waste that the yeast produce. And we know, as I mentioned before, that you can develop pathogenic candida. And we've moved here from a normal single-cell yeast form to more of this mycelium form, this hyphal form, where it starts to grow these filaments. And you can think about these filaments as being these fibers that will start to grow and embed themselves into the lining of the gut. And it's this switching forms that allows for these things to become invasive, to grow and spread themselves along tissues, as well as any types of surfaces where they might be. And in this case, we see these images here of different candida, specifically candida biofilms, on catheters and plastic. Now, they know that biofilms is a big problem, particularly in hospital settings. They know that these can be a source for secondary infections and can make it very difficult to try to control bacteria and yeast problems in hospital settings. Here we have biofilm growing on plastic, and this one here on the left-hand side is actually biofilm growing on a catheter. Bacteria also secrete biofilms. This is a staphylococcus bacteria, and if you really get a good look at this image here, you can see that it's almost like this biofilm is a transport medium. It's able, these bacteria can move along this biofilm. Other nutrients and chemicals can be transported to other areas of the biofilm to communicate. And there's a phenomenon called quorum sensing. And quorum sensing is where, in this case, we'll specifically address it to bacteria, where bacteria within the same family can secrete chemicals. And let's say we take this bacteria here up on top. Let me move this up and let me grab a little pen. Where we take this bacteria sitting over here, can secrete a chemical that can communicate with this bacteria sitting over here. And what quorum sensing can do is that these two bacteria can communicate with each other even though they might be at a significant distance. Now, one of the ways it certainly could do that is transport it more easily through a biofilm. Well, quorum sensing also shows that you may have two staphylococcus bacteria sitting here that are communicating with each other, but there are other chemicals that can be secreted that will start to interact with the entire colony of bacteria simultaneously. And so two staphylococcus bacteria may not be a big deal, but as you stimulate and activate 2,000 or whatever, 2 million staphylococcus bacteria almost instantaneously, now you have a rapid infection on hand on your hands. And that's exactly what's happening with many of these quick onset infections. Quorum sensing can also, through the process of, you know, chemical manipulation, is where various bacteria that might be in a different family can cause those bacteria to switch on as well. Because this, even though this may be a staphylococcus bacteria, you could have mixed bacteria or yeast sitting in this biofilm. So quorum sensing is a very interesting phenomena. And in the future, where they're really looking for treatment isn't so much to be creating antibiotics to attack a specific bacteria, okay, where we would tend to X out a particular bacteria. It's actually trying to go after these chemicals that, you know, the bacteria are releasing, and very likely yeast are releasing too, and try to basically block that chemical effect. Okay, so you'll probably hear as time goes on, you know, about quorum sensing, but I watched a presentation a while back with a molecular biologist talking about this, and it was quite fascinating. But the way it can work, and the way it can work most effectively, is through the mechanism and medium of a biofilm. Okay, and now this is a specific biofilm with respects to Candida. Here we have these hyphal, these filament forms of the yeast. This is an invasive form of yeast, and you can see now this biofilm that is being produced around it. And one thing that, you know, I learned in putting this presentation together, which is kind of surprising to me, was that there was some research that was shown that Candida infections are one of the most common hospital-based infections in the United States. They essentially account up for 10% of what are called the septicemias, which are systemic infections throughout the body, which is quite surprising, because normally you'd think of that with respect to bacterial problems. And it always, you know, when I look around and I hear, you know, other doctors talk about the fact that intestinal candida is not a big deal. Intestinal candida is not something that can cause problems. What they don't understand is that in order for candida to get into the bloodstream or into the lymphatic system or even invade into the tissues of the body, it has to get there through the gut. And the candida and the Candida albicans, if they are a normal inhabitant of our digestive system, and in for those things to cause systemic problems, there has to be some type of breakdown within the gut, either from the microenvironment of the other bacteria, from the immune system, through a leaky gut type of situation. And what they also don't understand is the chemical and direct chemical influence that the yeast produce, as I've pointed out, with arabinose, with aldehyde, with gliotoxins. So we don't have to have septicemia occurring, which means candida essentially growing in the lymphatic system and in the blood system to be causing problems. We know that candida just becoming mucosally invasive, which means embedding itself into the mucosal lining of the gut, but not necessarily growing full intact yeast in the bloodstream, and the chemicals it produces can have just a profound effect on somebody's health. And that's exactly what we see with many kids on the spectrum. Okay. We're going to talk a little bit about the biofilm program. And really, the credit for the biofilm program needs to go to Dr. Anju Usman, who's an MD, biomedical autism specialist in Illinois. And Dr. Usman's been a DAN physician for many, many years, has contributed a lot with respect to research and information. And she brought to the attention of the biomedical community a couple of years ago about this issue of biofilms. And so really, a lot of the credit needs to go to her for, you know, her research, through implementing it in her clinical practice, and just really sharing her information. There's a very interesting presentation you can watch. If you go to autism.com, which is the website for the Autism Research Institute, and if you go under, there's a link for podcasts, and the one that was most recent was the April 2009 DAN conference. And they have the presentations recorded. And I want to say her presentation, if I remember right, it was under the, I think it was under the science section, about midway down, you'll see it. Dr. Usman talks about biofilms. It's about an hour long, but it's fascinating, okay? So you want more information on that, go there. Okay, hold on 1 second here. Okay, a couple of things with respect to biofilms. We're specifically talking about yeast biofilms and bacterial biofilms. From my knowledge, viruses don't cause biofilms. I'm not sure about parasitic infections, but I don't believe, you know, that. But we're really specifically talking, I haven't seen any evidence for viral biofilms. There may be something out there, but I just haven't seen it. But we're specifically talking about bacterial biofilms and antifungal biofilms. And tonight, we're really specifically talking about Candida. But I want you to understand, when we go through these slides, much of the information can be applied to bacterial problems too. Because in many of the kids, you're not just dealing with one organism. I mean, you're dealing with a mixture of things. But I mean, I know our talk tonight is really about the problems of yeast, but we can see bacterial problems too. One of the things that, you know, the question comes up, well, how do you know whether to do a biofilm program? You know, how do you know it's going to be useful? Well, you don't always know whether it's going to be useful. You don't always know if it's going to help. Like many things in medicine, there's no one guarantee for any one treatment. And the same thing with biomedical therapies. You have no way of knowing whether it's going to help all kids at all times. But you implement based on your knowledge and, you know, clinical experience and whatnot. A couple of things, though, that I thought I've seen in my practice for years, and Dr. Usman pointed out too, that might help kind of pave the way to say, hey, maybe we'll give a biofilm program a try. And that is, if you've got a lack of stool culture findings for yeast and bacteria, but you've got experience in the past that your child, when they're placed on an antibiotic, and it could be for something, you know, like an ear infection or a suspected throat infection, or even an antifungal medication, and they've done much better from their autism standpoint, whether it's attention focusing behavior, eye contact, language has improved beyond what you would normally expect by just giving an antibiotic or an antifungal. Okay, that could be an indication that you might be dealing with a biofilm issue in your child. Another thing is that you've seen adverse behavior with your child, from aggression to head banging to agitation to tantrums, whatever it may be, that definitely seems to be related to gut. Okay, when their gut's working better, they're doing better. When they're pooping more regularly, they're doing much better. But you still have no direct evidence of digestive pathogens, okay? Again, there may be a biofilm issue. Individuals with obsessive compulsive behavior, perceptive behavior, ritualistic, tics, whatever it may be, who many times will tend to get worse seasonally. Could be spring, could be the fall. Again, they don't test specifically for an infection like strep, which sometimes can be associated with a condition called PANDAS, which is an autoimmune strep problem that can cause tics and obsessive compulsive behavior after a strep infection. But you don't have any test indications that would point to that, but you see this pattern every year. Again, there could be a potential of a biofilm problem. And then persistent, and this is something I see more commonly in my practice, just persistent unresolved yeast and bacterial issues on the organic acid test that just keep coming back and keep coming back, keep coming back. The rabinose levels don't go down, or they go down, they come right back. The HPA levels, which is indicative of Clostridia, maybe go away and then come right back. And, you know, you as a parent are doing a very regimented diet. You're controlling sugar intake. You're religious with your supplements. You're religious with, you know, your herbal remedies, antifungal therapy, and things just aren't resolving. It could be that a biofilm issue is a problem here. Here's the reality. All of us are going to have some level of biofilm in our body. I had an opportunity to speak with a fella who ran a lab that looked at biofilm, analyzing bacteria in biofilms in wound infections. And that was their specialty. And they were looking to expand in the future, trying to identify biofilms in stool samples. But at least right now, the technology is available to analyze bacteria and biofilms on in wounds, whether it was like somebody who had a burn or, you know, a patient with diabetic neuropathy where they've got wound infections, whatever it may be, okay? And as this fellow had indicated, that the latest research even shows that about 98-99% of bacteria and yeast that live in the natural world, just around us, and our body is the natural world too, live in a state of biofilm at one form or another. So you can almost make an assumption that we're all going to have a level of biofilm. It's just how pervasive it is. At this point, we just don't have any direct test to measure the extensiveness of this. So a lot of this is implemented based on clinical suspicion and just, you know, issues of things not resolving. Okay. So the biofilm program, as laid out by Dr. Usman, is pretty straightforward. Essentially, we're looking to break down that biofilm. And then step two is we're attacking the microbes that are living in the biofilm. Then we're cleaning up the mess. And then we're doing things long term to try to bring normal balance back to the gut. Now, the one thing about biofilms is they are, as I mentioned before, it's like this mucilaginous glob, in essence, and you saw some images of it. Well, what that glob is, or what that gooey-like substance is, are what are called polysaccharides, which are complex sugar molecules attached together that form this type of mucusy layer. And they are held together sort of by like a cytoskeleton of minerals, specifically calcium, magnesium, and iron. So the way I kind of imagine this is the iron, magnesium, and calcium is like a tinker toy structure. And you're layering on top of that this polysaccharide glue. Okay? So in order to effectively break down that biofilm, you need a couple things to do that. Okay? One is digestive enzymes. And this is some example of some remedies that are used. You need some digestive enzymes that can actually digest that polysaccharide glue, okay? And then you also need something to bind to the tinker toy structure, to the minerals, the iron, the calcium, and the magnesium. Well, Claire Labs has two products. One is called Interface Plus, and one is just called Interface. Interface Plus is the digestive enzymes plus sodium EDTA. Now, we've all heard about EDTA with respect to being part of some of the chelation programs, chelation, you know, program to kind of help remove heavy metals. You'll also find EDTA if you go look open, you know, you go look at your shampoo bottle, your conditioner bottle, or sometimes your lotion or whatever you put on your body, you know, sometimes you'll see EDTA in there as well. And they put EDTA many times in foods as a preservative. In this case, we're using specifically sodium EDTA, because EDTA taken orally is not absorbed to any significant degree at all, okay, has no comparison at all to IV EDTA. So don't worry about the toxicity issue that you hear about with respect to chelation therapy or EDTA, because it's not even in the same ballpark. But the reason the sodium EDTA is being used is you want that sodium EDTA to disassociate so that the EDTA has an opportunity to bind to the minerals, the magnesium, the calcium, or the iron, to break down that tinker toy structure, and then the enzymes in that product to basically break down that polysaccharide glue. Okay? If you gave calcium EDTA, well, one of the minerals that's found in the biofilm is calcium, so that really wouldn't accomplish what we're trying to accomplish here. And so essentially, Claire has two products, Interface and Interface Plus. New Beginnings is carrying now Interface Plus, and they're also carrying Interface as well. Some doctors will start with just the Interface first for kids who they think are just really, really, really sensitive to supplements. I usually start with the Interface Plus. I just tend to adjust my dosages, starting low, starting slow, and kind of building up. But basically, you're using digestive enzymes plus EDTA to kind of help break apart and detach that biofilm. Okay, and the important thing with these is they need to be taken on an empty stomach, a good 30 to 45 minutes before eating. The reason is there's enzymes in these products, So if you take them with food, they're just going to digest your food, and you want them to digest the biofilm. And I will normally set a program up where I might do once a day, sometimes twice a day. I'll normally start off slow, where we'll do it once a day, and then we'll kind of build up where we'll, over time, we'll implement a second dose, okay? So again, it needs to be taken, you know, at least 30 minutes before food. And essentially what happens is when you take it 30 to 45 minutes before food, that leads us into step two. Remember, step two was attacking the microbes, okay? Now we've broken down the biofilm. We've pulled out the minerals, so the tinkertoid disintegrates. We've added in the enzymes that start to chew up that polysaccharide glue. And now those microbes, those pictures that we saw, the yeast or bacteria, are kind of sitting there exposed. And this is where we come in with our specific antimicrobials or antifungals. If you're dealing with Clostridia that you have documented from an organic acid test, then you might be looking at something like Flagyl or vancomycin as a treatment. Maybe Alinea, which is another antibiotic that can be effective for those. If it's strep that you may be thinking is an issue, you know, what's called PANDAS, you know, child has ticks, child may have obsessive compulsive disorders that's being thought of as being potentially caused by a strep infection, you might be using something more like penicillin or Zithromax. You know, this is a different topic, but Lyme and these co-infections of Lyme can also create biofilm. And there's a whole organization out there called the Lyme-Induced Autism Association that has correlated Lyme's issues and Lyme's disease in some kids with autism. So that's another topic. But essentially, you're using your antimicrobials here, if it's a bacterial problem, to attack the microbes in the biofilm. And the same thing here with yeast, okay? So there's no one remedy that works 100% all the time. Whether it's Nystatin, Diflucan, Nizoral, or these natural remedies, sometimes you're using a combination of things to kind of go after these bugs. And I'll talk a little bit more about what are some of the dosages. What I want to just kind of get you the idea here is just the steps, is sort of how to proceed or how this biofilm program proceeds. Okay, so we've given the enzymes and the EDTA before food, and then a half hour later, you know, you might eat a little bit of food, because many of these medications sometimes are best taken with a little food to kind of prevent any type of nausea or discomfort. And now we're essentially killing the microbes. Well, now you've got these medications, these herbal remedies have gone to battle, and you know, after the battle's over with, for that period of time, you got a bunch of dead guys laying on the battlefield. And this is where we need to come in and do some cleanup, okay? And so step three is essentially an hour, hour and a half, 2 hours later, is where you start using binding agents. Activated charcoal is a specific binding agent that helps to bind up some of the toxins and some of the dead guys on the battlefield, okay? Pectazol is a product I've used in my practice. It's modified citrus pectin. It's a fiber source. Again, it can be helpful for binding up some of the debris. An interesting product called True Fiber, which is a product now available from New Beginnings, is a fiber source that can be used too. The nice thing about Pectazol or True Fiber is they're a fiber source too, which can help to bulk up the stool, which many times can help kids go to the bathroom easier. And then apple pectin is another, this is something you can even just get at a local health food store. Apple pectin is a fiber source, and that can kind of bind up some of the toxins as well. Usually, I think as far as the one that's used quite a bit as the specific binding agent is the activated charcoal. But I many times will also like to use something like True Fiber because it's a fiber source, which a lot of kids can use just overall as a tonifying thing for the digestive tract. And as I mentioned before, you can get activated charcoal from New Beginnings and the True Fiber from New Beginnings. I mention here True Fiber as a prebiotic fertilizer. And what I mean by that is True Fiber, in essence, can be considered a prebiotic, which is a substance that acts like a fertilizer for the good bacteria. So it helps to kind of lay down some nutrients that a lot of the good bacteria in the gut can thrive off of. So that True Fiber is a pretty nice product. All right. And then step four, we start getting into what are some additional considerations. with respects to trying over time to kind of change the ecosystem of the digestive tract. If you would like to learn how to make cultured vegetables, because one of the things that can really over time, and it's a taste, there's a acquired taste to this too. I wouldn't expect everybody here to go run out and make cultured vegetables for their kids and have them kids, you know, be eating this stuff three times a day. But it's something to look for, to try to change the diet and the health of your child. Cultured vegetables are an interesting way of doing that. And if you go to YouTube, just go to youtube.com, and right up above the banner on YouTube is a link called Channels. Type in Channels, and then type in Dr. Trancatella, comma, cultured vegetables. At the same, and you can also do my name, Dr. Woeller, comma, coconut kefir. And that'll take you to our YouTube channel. Dr. Trancatella is my partner, and this is there's a video on there, and she's discussing how to make cultured vegetables, okay, at home. It's real simple. I have a video on how to do coconut kefir. Kefir is a type of fermented drink, essentially using coconut. And all of these things are really helpful for implanting amino acids, enzymes, live enzymes, and live bacteria. And what they do over time is they help to change the pH, the acid-alkaline balance. You'll see a lot of kids, when you do stool tests, you see that their pH is very low, which means their stool is very acidic. And these provide growth factors, almost sort of like fertilizer for the good bacteria in the digestive tract. Okay, so those things you can get right off of YouTube. Another interesting drink is something called kombucha. And there's a good company called Synergy Drinks. Go to synergydrinks.com. And essentially this is similar to a tea. It's a fermented product, contains live enzymes and probiotics. And that might be something easier for you to begin with. And they have a bunch of different flavors. You're usually going to find it at the health food store. You won't be able to find it usually at your local regular grocery store, but more of a specialty market. And you know, each bottle, they're about $3.50, and you can try some different flavors. Again, you may just have to start in small amounts, but the kombucha is kind of a nice product too. So those are things that would be used to just sort of change the ecosystem of the gut. Okay. Well, we all heard about diets. We know about medical diets, from the gluten casein free and the specific carbohydrate. There's another one called the body ecology diet. All these medical diets, their main goal and their primary focus, physiologically anyway, is to decrease toxicity, to help reduce inflammation, to help bring normal function to the digestive tract, promote growth of normal bacteria, so that gut function is improved over time. I'm not going to go into all these medical diets. That's sort of a whole topic itself. But I just want you to make you aware that a big part of any type of program that addresses yeast is going to fall at the doorstep of diet. I mentioned before about some of the yeast behaviors. When you start thinking about treatment considerations, you know, I mentioned before about the silliness, the goofiness, the giddiness, the inappropriate laughter, which can very much be specific for yeast in a child who's neurologically sensitive to the yeast. So that can be, if you're seeing that type of thing, sure enough, there may be a yeast problem involved here. These are some slides from Dr. Shaw that talk about die-off. Now, sometimes when you implement a biofilm program, you may get a bit of a die-off reaction. Okay, and what die-off is, essentially all these toxins that we saw before. We talked about arabinose, tartaric acid, and gliotoxins, whatever it might be. Okay, as those yeasts start to die off, a lot of those toxins will be increased and dumped out of the yeast cells, and they have to go somewhere. If they can't be eliminated real quickly through the digestive tract, or they're not being released enough quickly through the kidneys into the urine, they can spill over and they can cause an initial aggravation of symptoms. So you may have a child who is goofy, giddy, silly, inappropriate laughter, stimmy, toe walks, lack of eye contact. When you start treating yeast, sometimes those issues can be heightened for 3-4 days, and then they can start to diminish. Hyperactivity, increased stereotypical behavior can all be increased by die-off. Same thing can happen with bacterial die-off. Clostridia, when you start treating bacteria, Clostridia bacteria, your child, if that's the case, may get a little bit more agitated, a little bit more out of sorts, and then that can back away. Okay, so die-off is always something to recognize. I've never believed that you have to see die-off in order to see benefit from these treatments. Okay, I've seen plenty of kids just get improvement right away without ever going through die-off. And usually die-off too is, if it's going to occur, will usually occur within the first 48 to 72 hours, may last anywhere between 3 to 5 to 7 days, and then will usually go away. It's not something that's typically lasting for weeks and months on end. Okay. You can also get die-off by implementing a biofilm program. You can get die-off by doing an anti-candida diet initially. You can get die-off by implementing a specific carbohydrate diet. Anytime you change what you're feeding the yeast, or the immune function in the gut, or the pH and the acid-alkaline balance, and the yeast don't like it, and they some of these colonies start dying off, you can get these symptoms. Okay, so one thing, as I mentioned before, is the activated charcoal. That's something to kind of keep on hand. You know, 1 to 2 capsules, you know, at night, maybe another capsule during the day, as a way to bind up some of these toxins, can be helpful in reducing some of the die-off. Let's see, I think this is kind of just, yeah, this one's pretty, I'll just let you read this real quickly. All right. A real good book, if you haven't gotten it, another book here, is Nourishing Hope from Julie Matthews. From a dietary perspective, this is a great book. She also does a very good job in giving a good overview of biomedicine in general, and gives a good description of some of the different types of diets, the specific carbohydrate, the anti-yeast, gluten casein free. And I'd encourage everybody to have this book. She's also a great nutritionist to you know, consult with. There are other nutritionists around, you know, in the biomedical community as well. But she's done a nice job, I think, just from the standpoint of laying down why it's important, you know, to implement some of the dietary strategies for gut problems and yeast problems in general. So Nourishing Hope is a good book to have on hand. Let's talk a little bit here about yeast treatments. Now, when I used to see these kind of slides in medical school, my head would start to spin, because it didn't have much meaning to me when I knew that I didn't have any direct access at that time to prescribe any of this stuff. And so I don't expect people here, unless there's physicians listening, to be able to memorize all this stuff. I just wanted to kind of give you a flavor that there is no one best antifungal treatment for all kids. There is no one best time frame as far as treating for yeast that we can specifically state for all kids. There's no one magic dosage that is specific for all kids. What we have learned clinically over time is what we would all suspect. Every kid is different. You're probably tired of hearing it, but it's true. Every kid's different. They don't all respond to the same thing. You have to try different medications. You have to try different forms of treatment, sometimes co-treatments, and you have to try different dosages. So, and that's essentially what this slide is getting at. Nystatin has been around for a long, long time. It's a very safe medication. It's a medication that you can think of that only generally tends to act locally in the gut. Okay, I think of nystatin like Pepto-Bismol. Pepto-Bismol coats the stomach. Nystatin coats the inside lining of the digestive tract. It doesn't get absorbed into the body to any significant degree, so therefore it's not going to have any potential stress on liver or kidney function. So it can be taken for prolonged periods of time really without issue. And in many cases in my practice, I've used it for quite a significant amount of time. without the need for doing blood work. Okay, not that I would never do blood work, but it's not something that you're seeing liver toxicity from. The dosage range depends on the comfort level of the doctor. I tend to be a little bit more assertive with my prescriptions because, you know, I've been in practice quite some time. I've got a lot of experience. Sometimes you have to really pull things and go for a higher dose to knock these yeast back. So I tend to, you know, to use things sometimes upwards of 500,000, 750,000, or even a million units 3 to 4 times a day. Okay, and I will typically prescribe for 30, 60, or 90 days ongoing, you know, to really try to get a handle on things. There are those that will argue that nystatin is not a good first-line thing to use for yeast. And I can make the case that that may be applicable in some cases where something more like diflucan might be more effective. But logistically, sometimes in practice, particularly if you don't have blood work or you don't have the ability to get blood work, you know, I still have found nystatin to be pretty darn effective for a lot of kids. Amphotericin B is another antifungal, very similar in some respects to the way nystatin functions. Again, taken orally is very safe, can be taken long term. If you were to give nystatin IV or amphotericin B IV, then they can become quite toxic. That isn't happening in our practice and in the field of biomedicine. Okay, the downside to amphotericin B is it does need to be compounded from a compounding pharmacist, and it can be pretty pricey compared to nystatin. So it's much more expensive. But you can think of those two things, amphotericin B and nystatin, as being effective for surface level yeast in the gut. Amphotericin B would be a little bit more specific for some of the mold infections like Aspergillus. Then you step into the systemic antifungals, the Diflucan, the Nizoral, the Sporinox. Diflucan and Nizoral are usually the ones that are used most commonly, with Diflucan heading the list. And Diflucan has been around a long time, comes as an oral suspension, comes as a tablet. And you can also get this compounded, you know, from compounding pharmacies, which are special pharmacies that buy these medications in bulk and then prepare them without preservatives. The 4 to 6 milligram per kilogram dose is sort of an on average. I typically on average will use a 5 milligram per kilogram dose. And minimally, I wrote 15 to 30 days. The reason I put 15 is that when Diflucan is put as an oral suspension, it usually has an expiration of 14 days, and then you have to get it refilled because it doesn't last that long in an oral suspension. But I'll typically write for a 30-day prescription, and I may go longer. I might go 45, 60 days. If I have some blood work on hand where I know that liver function is okay, I may go longer in that case. And I have at times used Diflucan and nystatin at the same time. And, you know, particularly if we don't see things improving. I have not in my practice seen a significant problem with liver toxicity. There's a lot discussed about that on the internet. You read it in the medical journals. It's just not something that comes up really, I don't want to say never, but doesn't really come up in clinical practice. I've seen a few kids have some transient increases in their liver enzymes. Was it due to Diflucan or was it due to a host of other things? Difficult to say, but it is a good idea to be doing blood work, you know, every couple of months if you're going to be on Diflucan or one of these other systemic antifungals long term. You can also rotate them, where you can do, you know, 2 weeks on, 1 week off, 30 days on, 2 weeks off. Some doctors are more comfortable doing that. Well, they'll put 30 days of Diflucan and then go off of it for 2 weeks, and then do Nizoral for 30 days, then go off of it. And I've done that as well. I wish I could give you a magic formula for all of these remedies. The problem is there really is none. there is no one way of dosing these things. So for you as a parent out there, it's just being familiar with the fact and being comfortable with the fact that these medications have been used for a long, long time. The information you hear about, you know, liver toxicity issue with respects to something like Diflucan or Nizoral, really in my experience, and this is just my experience, is overblown. And I've seen and have provided thousands and thousands of dosages of these things without seeing any ill effects, or should I say permanent ill effects, from their use. So I've actually found these things to be very safe to take over prolonged periods of time. But again, doing blood work, particularly when using systemic antifungals, is important. And then we get into the realm of natural remedies. Sometimes if you have a comprehensive digestive stool analysis where you've been able to find out on culture, if they could culture the yeast, which antifungals are most effective, sometimes you don't always have that luxury, so you're left with trying to use some different types of natural remedies to kind of deal with the situation. Grapeseed seed extract and oil of oregano. If I had to pick from the natural remedies that are on the list of things that you'll typically hear, from grapeseed seed extract to caprylic acid to golden seal to uva ursi to olive leaf extract to oil of oregano, the grapeseed seed extract and the oil of oregano tend to come back pretty positive as far as their positive results on treating yeast, both on testing and report back from parents pretty consistently. So I think for the most part, if you were sort of kind of picking some remedies off a list, those two would be the things that I would generally tend to start with. And those two can be rotated, you know, every 3 to 5 days. But again, it's not, there's not a magic formula. And some kids do pretty well at rotating. Some kids do well with just keeping them on those for 2 or 3 weeks and then moving to a different remedy. But again, as you can see, when you're talking about yeast treatments, if you're not seeing resolution, it's where the biofilm, I think, many times needs to be implemented. Let's talk real quickly. I think I already kind of touched on this a little bit, you know, about nystatin versus diflucan. Essentially what nystatin does, also amphotericin B, is it binds to this chemical called ergosterol. And what ergosterol is, it's fairly unique to fungus. And essentially these organisms use ergosterol as a way to build their cell membranes. It's actually very similar to cholesterol in our cell membranes. And what the nystatin does is it punches holes in that cell membrane of the yeast, and that causes potassium to leak, and essentially the cell dies. Okay, so that's what essentially those nystatin and amphotericin B are doing. As I mentioned before, if you gave them IV, they can be toxic, but taken orally, they're actually very safe. And then, you know, the various dosages, you know, with respects to these medications. Diflucan is in the nice Nizoral, Sporinox, and Lamisil have a similar activity, except what these things do is they inhibit a specific enzyme called P450. And the P450 regulates something called 14-alpha-demethylase. And 14-alpha-demethylase is necessary to produce ergosterol. So it's having an effect in ergosterol function with respect to cell membrane formation, except that what diflucan and these other remedies are doing is they're affecting the enzyme that helps to produce ergosterol, whereas the nystatin is punching holes in the cell membrane of the yeast. Okay. The thing about the diflucans and these systemic antifungals, they tend to be rapidly absorbed from the digestive tract. So they absorb from the digestive tract within about 2 hours, and these will have an effect throughout the body. This is why they can give diflucan for a woman with a vaginal yeast infection, and it has an effect in the vaginal area. It's because it's being absorbed systemically, flowing through the bloodstream to different parts of the body, and it's not just staying local in the gut. And why things like Lamisil and Sporinox are prescribed for toenail fungus. You know, you're not rubbing a cream on your toenail. You're taking a medication internally to kill fungus that's affecting the toenail, and it's because they get systemically absorbed, okay? There is a risk of liver stress. I don't want to state that there isn't, but it's not something that is typically found, at least not in my practice. A couple other natural remedies you can consider. I've had some pretty good success with Candex. Candex is a natural remedy. You can get it from New Beginnings as well. And what Candex is, it's a variety of different enzymes. Similar to Interface Plus, where the Interface Plus had enzymes that was breaking down the biofilm, Candex tends to break down the cell wall of Candida, okay? Because primarily a large portion of the cell membrane of Candida is made up of fiber. And so the Candex essentially helps to break down the cell membrane. And the cool thing about it is that Candida doesn't have really a defense mechanism against it. So it's not, you're not going to develop resistance to Candex. 1 to 2 daily between meals, and or, you know, a couple hours after food. Usually it's only taken once a day. I've had a few kids take it twice a day without problems. But Candex is kind of a nice thing. But again, it is a little difficult with kids that can't swallow capsules. You know, you might be able to mix a little bit of juice, but it's definitely got to be taken on an empty stomach. Probably all heard about 3-lac, and I've seen some good things with 3-lac. There's another one out now called 5-lac, but 3-lac is more common. It's made in Japan. It's made of 2 soil-based organisms and 1 what's called lactic acid bacteria. And essentially, the lactic acid bacteria called Enterococcus faecalis supports those 2 other organisms in the 3-lac, and it's those 2 other organisms which are the ones that specifically attack yeast. So you could really think of 3-lac as an anti-yeast probiotic. Okay, the general recommendations are 3 months on, 7 days off before restarting it. I'll usually have kids start off slow, half pack, you know, within 2-3 days, work up to a full pack, and then you can increase slowly over time. Most of the time with kids, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years old, I might get them up to 2 packs over time. I never start at that high a dose, though. Okay. The only downside to 3-lac is it does contain something called fructooligosaccharides, also abbreviated FOS. And FOS can aggravate if there's an underlying bacterial problem. Not in all cases, but in some kids. So if you give 3-lac and you just feel like, you know, the child is becoming more aggravated and is doing worse on it over time, meaning, you know, 10, 14, 21 days into it, it may be that some of these other components are aggravating them. It does contain a very, very small amount of casein, usually at the same level as something called Culturelle. Culturelle, although you can get Culturelle now made milk-free, those remedies always had a very small amount of casein in them. Nothing that was ever enough to really cause a significant problem for the majority of kids. Every once in a while, I'd have a child that might have a bit of a casein sensitivity, but it was far and few between. And then, of course, we get into the aspect of just probiotics themselves, okay? And there's a whole list, a laundry list here of things to use. Again, there's not one best thing to use. Let me just kind of tell you real quickly, when you start thinking about probiotics, and many of these are available from New Beginnings. You can get, you know, there's a few probiotics from Kirkman. New Beginnings carries Therabiotics, which is a Claire product. That is a multi-flora probiotic. It has a wide variety of different types of natural bacteria. That, to me, would be something that would be considered like a multivitamin for the gut. It's just a multi-flora probiotic, okay? New Beginnings carries a product called Probiotic Support Formula. Again, that's a multi-flora probiotic. That's like a multivitamin for the gut, okay? MindLinks is something that some people have used. Again, it's sort of a multi-spectrum probiotic. So that you could think of just sort of as a baseline, cover your bases probiotic. But if you're specifically going after a particular bacteria or yeast, that's where things get a little more specific. 3-lac is really a specific probiotic to go after Candida, okay? That wouldn't, 3-lac wouldn't necessarily be something that you would use as to just try to seed the gut with a wide spectrum of good bacteria. It has a specific treatment effect. Culturelle is one specific type of bacteria called Acidophilus GG, and it has a specific function where it likes to go after Clostridia bacteria. Again, you wouldn't use it as just a probiotic to give sort of a wide sweeping effect. You're using it specific for a treatment effect. VSL3 is a very high potency probiotic with a various number of bacteria. It's primarily in the biomedical arena being used to help reduce oxalates. And if you haven't heard about oxalates, we can talk about that another time, but that has a specific function in helping to reduce oxalate levels. And I think I'm missing one. The last one is Saccharomyces boulardii. Saccharomyces boulardii is a type of yeast. It's actually an anti-yeast yeast. And it has a specific effect where it will actually crowd out yeast, and it will also go after Clostridia. So it has can have a dual effect for Clostridia problems and yeast problems, but it's not something that you would use in isolation to try to seed the gut with normal bacteria. So there's different probiotics that have different treatment effects, and then you have some that are just sort of like a multivitamin for the gut. Okay, so to finish up here, kind of to finalize this for you, Candida support, we know it's problematic, we know it's pervasive. It's something that I think is universal within the field of biomedicine for autism, and really universal within people in general who have any type of health problem. Okay, diet is always key, and diet is one of the things that we know not only helps kids from a straight gluten casein free standpoint, but the specific diets that specifically address gut function, anti-yeast diets, specific carbohydrate, body ecology diet, those help to change the ecosystem of the gut, which starts to create an environment where yeast don't like to live. Okay, probiotic supports, again, important part of this whole matrix of things we're looking for. Of course, antifungal support of a wide variety of things, from medications to natural remedies. A lot of people forget that you'll never get yeast conditions under control if you don't deal with the bacteria and sometimes the parasitic infections that can show up as well. So the other thing I want to point out too is don't ever expect to think that you're going to get rid of all of the yeast, that you're going to completely eradicate the body of Candida. It's not going to happen. It's a natural part of our environment, and in some level it's a natural part of the gut. What you're really looking for over time is an improvement in your child's own body's ability to deal with these toxins, to where they don't become so neurologically sensitive anymore. And sometimes that can take years of treatment. I wish it only took months, or even better yet, weeks. But in some kids, it can take a year to a year and a half, two, sometimes 3 years, for things to normalize. So this is not a program that is implemented just for a couple weeks and you walk away. These are things that have to be implemented over time. And I know that's a lot to swallow when you're in the middle of this, but that's the reality. The other thing, too, with Candida is just biomedical programs in general help to decrease toxicity. And just decreasing the toxic effects overall of foods, or of heavy metals or other infections. People often say, well, you have to get rid of the heavy metals before you get your yeast under control. Well, yeah, that can be true on one level, because heavy metals we know can affect the immune system. But again, the reality is you're never going to completely eradicate heavy metals from the body 100%, because none of us live in a bubble. And there's always going to be the potential for re-exposure. So what you're trying to do over time is just decrease the toxic stressors of food, of infections, of gut toxins, of heavy metals. And then most importantly with anything, from whether it's non-biomedical related, from ABA to speech to OT to biomedical, yeast treatment, diet, methyl B12 supplements, is being persistent and consistent over time. It's just keep moving forward and keep implementing these things and keep searching, keep learning, is the most important aspects to helping your children. One of the things on Autism Action Plan that I strive to do is to help parents who may be working with a doctor who just want to brainstorm with another physician, or have some questions that sometimes can't get answered. That's what I do all the time on Action Plan website. If you're a parent out there who isn't working with a doctor, who maybe you're experienced in what you've implemented over time, and you just, again, want to have access to a biomedical physician who you can ask questions of, that's what my involvement with Autism Action Plan is all about. There's a very active parent forum where I'm answering questions every day on here. Parents who don't have a doctor, and parents who are working with another damn doctor, who just want another pair of eyes, somebody else to ask questions of, to kind of brainstorm. That's what I do, and that's the one reason I created this website. The other thing, you know, with this website is we have video chats. And these video chats we hold twice a week, where you go onto the website live. You don't need any special equipment, any cameras, and I'm answering your questions live. You can type them. You basically type them in, and I'll answer them for you. And that's a very popular part of this site. The other thing, too, is that there's a tremendous amount of other information. There's other video lectures that we have on that website. There are protocols, like that biofilm protocol that I laid out. There's a large example of that on that website that you can have access to. There are prescription download handouts for things like Diflucan and vancomycin and nystatin that are already pre-made up, and they're specific for a couple different pharmacies, Hopewell Wellness and Part Pharmacy out in California, that can be taken to your doctor and just basically with their signature can be sent to those pharmacies, and you can get, you know, compounded medications. So a lot of great stuff. Check it out if you want to get more information. You can go to www.autismactionplan.org, and you can also access it through Great Plains website as well. If you go to greatplainslaboratory.com, there's a specific link right here to autismactionplan.org. There's also right now on the homepage of that website, there's a free ebook that you can get. If you just enter your name and email address, that ebook you'll be able to download as well. So anyway, I hope you found this information useful. I know there's a lot of stuff. As I mentioned before, if anybody came on late, I'm now able to answer questions through the parent forum, through the webinar. You can always join me on the website and, you know, ask your questions there. So we'll see you in 1 month, where we'll be talking about another topic. And hope all of you have a good night and a good month. And we'll touch base soon, okay? Take care.